Prova, prova, prova.
Solo un momento, scusate.
Laudator Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ. We're about to begin a briefing, the first during the 16th Ordinary General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops. The Prefect of the Dicastery for Communication, Paolo Ruffini.
Buongiorno, bentrovati tutti.
Good day. Hello to everyone. We have this first briefing about the opening of the proceedings. The working groups happened this morning. He'll be talking a little bit about all this work and about the presentation of the Instrumentum Laboris.
I segni caratteristici di una chiesa sinodale e un modo per di procedere per la chiesa sinodale la conversazione nello spirito. Abbiamo un po' di materiale su questa conversazione e manderemo subito dopo il briefing delle info utili a tutti voi gli accreditati, sia gli ordinari che i temporanei, quindi tutto il materiale anche che verrà proiettato qua avrete in seguito subito dopo. Allora, al dottor Ruffini.
And now I'm giving Buongiorno, the floor to qui.
Our prefect. Good morning to everyone.
La cosa che vorrei fare so the first thing I would like to Sheila do Perez,
is to introduce to you Sheila Perez, who is the secretary of the
Commission for Information. Eletti,
the other members
mattina.
Are going to be
Intanto
elected
la qui
Monday morning. So she,
lei però forse non dovrebbe avere un
perhaps Sheila Perez was born in Mozambique, so her mother tongue is Portuguese, but she works in South Africa, so she speaks excellent English. Quindi ci sarà la traduzione. Ci sarà la traduzione simultanea.
It's easy to understand all our languages. Ieri avete potuto
yesterday
seguire interamente
you
la
were able
giornata.
To follow the first
mi spiace, mi
day
and
I apologize if there were problems to follow the proceedings of work and also simultaneous translation. Now you should have translation into English
Oggi,
and Portuguese.
Sapete,
so as you know today the small circles work started. They are part of those moments which are confidential, and the Pope yesterday explained why, to give priority to listening the others and the Holy Spirit, to take a break against the din that we are immersed on and to discern. And though it does not imply that you cannot write, we will give you some material, but if I may, there is this suspension of time, this deafening silence. It's not, we're not going to have this background din. So such a great institution as the Church now is taking a time to make common discernment in silence, listening, faith, communion and prayer. So this is this abstinence, this fasting, let's say, from sound and noise is what is important. This was told to us a month ago by the Pope, who was speaking about the Synod, and this can help the world also in other contexts and in connection with other issues, such as the war. So it's important to stop for a moment. Let us consider the climate crisis that is that the apostolic exhortation is addressed to. So stop and listen. This is a challenge that is worth sharing, and this is the first new element in this synod, I think. But the Pope told us the work of journalists is extremely important in order to understand and make people understand all this. So knowing, being aware that the priority is listening. We are here to try and help you in your work and to explain to you how the first meeting of the small circles was held this morning and what was explained to every member of the synod. And I'm giving the floor, do la parola a Sheila Perez, con l'aiuto di alcune diapositive vi spiegherà ciò che è stato spiegato a tutti noi e quindi adesso verrà spiegato a voi come si lavora nei circoli minori.
Buongiorno, boa tarde.
Buongiorno a tutti. Allora, siamo stati introdotti.
What is happening is, as Dr. Paolo Ruffini has just said, is the minor circles, that is every delegate or member, we've been split into different groups according to language, and also, and we have a facilitator. Basically, the role of the facilitator is to ensure that the exchange from a methodological point of view is really observed during this process. So, for example, today people were encouraged to share their experiences during this synodal process prior to coming here. So that's basically what we did this morning, sharing our different experiences. We had about 4 minutes to do this type of presentation. And from there, we exchange what we all rather present our different experiences. From there, we are then encouraged to share, to listen to each other and share what really touched us, what really stood out based from the information shared from the other participants. And I must say, there's also space or room for silence, because as the Pope says, the protagonist of this synodal experience is the Holy Spirit. And in order for that to happen, there has to be moments of prayer, moments of silence. And so we are having those here and there. And from there, we then share once again the third round. The third round is now when we draft what is common or what is important that came out from each participant. We then draft a mini report, which will then be shared with the entire group. But remember that these minor groups are made up of a secretary, a facilitator, as I've mentioned. There's also a secretary, and there's a special rapporteur who will be the one to report to the wider group what we have been discussing in the small groups. So in a nutshell, that's basically what we've, that's the model, rather, that we have approached between now and Saturday. So yeah, that's basically in a nutshell. Thank you.
We can go through the slides so we could together we can explain me and Sheila. You will see what was okay. This is the methodology that was used this morning to explain to every one of us, members of the synod, to understand how to work in these days. So the first slide is something you already know. The second, okay. So the segment A, B, and B1, B2, B3, and then the conclusion and proposals. So all the way we will go through. And so the other slides is what Sheila just said. The introduction, the working groups, the penalization, and then the working groups again. So what's going on is that in every group we have several times to speak each member. Today, for example, in my group we spoke 3 times each member, and then we will, as Sheila just said, we will go to the plenary assembly, and then hearing from what will be the reaction of the work in every group and the reaction of anyone who wants to have give us a speech in of 4 minutes maximum in the plenary session. Then we go back to the minor circles, and then we will give the relation. Each relation will take notes of what where there is the agreement, where there is disagreement and proposals.
Ricordo se ci sono proposte e visioni per il futuro.
The report will be of 2 pages. You will have sent this so you can work on it. It's just to show the report should next. Sorry? Yes, we will send it. The report should collect points of convergence and divergence, if I pronounce. Is that right, the pronounce? Divergence?
Yes, divergence.
Okay. Tensions that have emerged and questions that remain open. So it's an open report. It will also contain insights and proposals for concrete steps to be taken in relation to the issues addressed. Outcomes 2, okay, brief intervention. This will mean that, for example, tomorrow, what was said in the minor circles today, there will be a rapporteur for each circle that will sì. Okay. Ci sarà un rapporteur che restituirà all'assemblea il lavoro di ogni circolo. Come saranno approvate le relazioni?
So, an important thing, notice, is how the report are going to be approved. The report and the intervention are going to report on consensus and divergences, and the report has to be approved by the absolute majority of the members, testifying to the fact that the report faithfully represents the work of the group. So Sheila has explained this, the role of the facilitator.
Questo è quello che avviene in questa assemblea.
This is what happens in this assembly in all modules. Now we are focusing on module A, then will be B1, B2 and B3. And for every module, there's going to be this type of work. So discussion in the small circles, a brief verbal report by a rapporteur to the congregation, general congregation, then going back to the small circles to complete. I'm sorry that I'm taking up longer than I. There is considerable freedom. And everybody has the opportunity of taking the floor more than once within every small circle meeting. So, and then everybody can speak to the general congregation, and the report is going to highlight points of convergence and divergence, and then the expert facilitator has the role of giving the floor to people and ensure that they do not take up more time than is available, otherwise not everybody, you know, can take the floor if people speak for too long. It's 4 minutes. 4 minutes per person. And then, of course, sometimes people speak for less than 4 minutes, and then we manage to take a further round of contributions. In every small circle, for every module, there's going to be a rapporteur who is elected, appointed, and then a secretary is appointed, and a rapporteur. But they can be both men and women. The way in which the rapporteur is going to be elected, and this was done today, is a ballot, so everybody can vote and say who he or she thinks would be a good rapporteur, and there is a first ballot count. And then some ballots, votes come up. So based on what happens, there is again a second ballot, And based on the second ballot, a third ballot is cast concerning the two people that have received the most votes. And then the person who has received the majority of votes for every circle and in every circle and for every module, there's going to be this procedure. You know that circles will change in every module. Now, at the moment, I am in one module in a circle. In the next module, I will be in another circle. Or group. Yes, the first thing that happened this morning was in every circle or group, small group, was the people introduced themselves. My name is Paolo, I am so and so. Some of us knew already each other. And then the second thing was vote for the rapporteur for this section. So it's a service role which is carried out, and then there is going the draft report is then taken into the small group or circle and is discussed by the group, small group, and is changed if there are things to be added. And then the report is going to show points of convergence, of divergence, insights, ideas that have come up. And what we are doing in this circle, in this section, or session, sorry, and we should also provide you with the further information. So as far as point A is concerned, there were no further questions in the Instrumentum Laboris, so we will be given this. The first session is an account of the experience made by every member in the synodal path followed up until today, vis-à-vis the synodal church, how the church is living all this based on what happened in the diocese and in the members, etc., to try and understand what is working, what could be done differently, and what can be shared to follow a synodal journey together. And that you will be given these pages. Christiane has just confirmed this. Unfortunately, the interpreter cannot translate questions because they're not asked into a live microphone. So, per se, this is not going to be very interesting for journalists. Sorry, we don't know what the subject is. I didn't have them because technically we didn't have the time, because when the small group came to an end, I went for lunch. People went for lunch and I had some Dicastery meetings, and then I came here, so physically I didn't have the time. Again, the interpreters apologize, but we cannot translate questions, so we don't know what was asked. No, the secretaries were appointed by the secretariat of the synod, at least in my circle. Sorry, can I interrupt? If you could ask questions later, we are broadcasting this in streaming and we cannot translate the question. So in this slide you see what we mean by this conversation in the spirit. I think you know about this anyway. It's a dynamic that the members of the synod have experimented also during this spiritual retreat in Sacrofano. And so there are moments of silence and prayer between one moment and the next. So there are several rounds, and we start with a prayer that you were, that you witnessed this morning in live streaming, and then the discussion starts with moments of prayer between one part and the next. And there are also moments of prayer in silence. And in my circle or group, we prayed a Hail Mary. So here again, you see explained again what we mean by the conversation in the spirit. And every participant has the possibility, but this is not an obligation, of sending their intervention, contribution to the secretariat of the synod, what this person said in the small circles, for because that this is, can be used in the final report. And and then we prayed together. So we spoke about the general congregations. We've already told you about this. Anyway, this sheet of paper which we were given will be shared with you, so you can use it in your work. I don't know if there's anything more I should say before we take our questions. Well, yes, you will be given further material. You're going to be given the letter that we received from the Bishop of Assisi. You will be given some information concerning what is going to happen in the Basilica between 7 and 8. So you will be giving all this material, which gives you further information. So if there are questions, Sheila and myself are here to answer you in the languages we know. Let us give the floor to Angela. She raised her hand first. Very quickly, if I'm not mistaken from your agenda, on the 7th, the final report of the small circles should be given, in other words, on Saturday, if I'm not wrong, if I remember correctly. And these reports, are we going to receive them as you did in the past or not? No, you're not going to get to receive them. You're not going to receive them because these are going to be given to the Secretariat of the Synod, and they will work on the final report. Can you introduce yourself, please? Thank you. Marco Politi, Il Fatto Quotidiano blog. I just wanted to understand the mechanism. In other words, there is this meeting of the small circles which started now. The small circles develop a first report, which is then presented to the General Assembly, is that which is a second step, right? And then you vote on this first, let's say, provisional temporary report. Then the General Assembly only then discusses when there is a second step, in other words, the presentation of the reports from the small circles or groups, yes. Then there are the final reports of the circles, and then again the General Congregation takes place. No, the General Congregation steps in after the number two report, based on the discussion in the General Congregation. Every circle will complete its report and sends it to the Secretariat of the Synod, so then it's included in what is going to be presented at the end when the final document is discussed. So the General Congregation is only convened in this intermediary phase, yes, for every module, but then there is an entire phase which is devoted to going through on a step-by-step basis, going through all the modules during the final discussion on the final or synthesis document. Diane Montagna.
Buongiorno.
Good morning, Diane Montagna.
Posso domandare, faccio la domanda in inglese.
Ask in English.
Sì, vabbè. Due domande. La prima, why are the participants required to maintain silence? Faccio riferimento al regolamento.
I'm referring to the regulation, anche in relazione ai propri interventi in occasione.
Once the assembly has ended, how can they serve as witnesses to what happened at the assembly during the next phase of the synodal process if they're required to remain silent? Of course, this rule raises the question of whether the same participants will be here next year in October 2024.
Okay.
And just
one question for time, so that I can try to give an answer without forgetting anything. La ragione del silenzio l'ha spiegata meglio di come potrei io il Papa ieri e anche nei giorni precedenti. Viene da due cose che hanno le radici nella Bibbia e nel Vangelo.
These are taking time to discern, for discernment, so taking time for listening to each other, taking time, this is the... So having time for discernment in the Spirit, something which is slow, because people need to listen to each other, precisely to know about point of convergence and divergence. And the second reason comes from the fact that the synod is like a body. It is a body, it's an us. So we ask every member to be aware of the fact that his or her contribution is within a discernment, which is in the communion of the entire synodal assembly. So it's a matter of taking time and to have that humbleness, which also marked the first Christians and the Church, to understand that my own personal thought and discernment is offered to a discernment of a communion that transcends me within a sharing, which also may sound laborious from a methodological standpoint, but I only participate in one small circle or group, and I'm trying to tell you as much as possible in order to allow you to then be able to tell in turn others about this experience. This is a true experience of communion and sharing, in which what counts rather than my own personal experience is this sharing of my personal experience within a collective experience. So this is what then we then try to tell. This is what makes us confident by faith, that through faith, that this is going to help us discern something that transcends us and that comes from God and the Holy Spirit in communion. So this is the reason why. It's just this, it's a method that comes from the conviction and the faith in that we are a single body and we are together. Everybody is a limb of the other, in a sense, and we try to respect this also in our in what we express.
But to follow up on what you said, what do you say to all of the Catholics who are watching this synod and certainly don't feel that they are part of this corpo, part of this body? They certainly don't feel included as part of this noi, part of this us. And now they're being told that for the next year, everyone who took part in this will have to maintain silence about what happened here. I think many people are particularly concerned. Let's say many women from the United States, North America, who, having looked at the list of members who have been sent here, many of the women who are here hold positions that are contrary to the Catholic faith. So what do you say, especially to women who don't feel at all that they're part of this noi or part of this body, and now they're being told it's all going to be silent until next year?
No.
I very briefly can say, and in simple terms, that the synod is a journey. It's a journey which started, and we are more or less halfway through, but not in terms of years, but in terms of a journey, which is going to make a comeback
in
individual areas, nations and continents, and then which is going to come back to Rome. So it's not that this suspension is going to take place now to allow the members of the synod to carry out their discernment. Then the synodal journey will continue, and the members who are here are here to do this, and we believe that they are here to do this. Otherwise, we would not give any value to the assembly itself, which is called upon to carry out a discernment within its internal corpus. So it's an assembly that has to do this. And I think that the people of God, this is what I think, the people of God has understood this or can understand it, because it is something that in some way is also easy to understand in our personal lives, that there are moments when you are thinking. In our case, we're not even going to take a decision, because this doesn't mean that the Synod takes a decision. The Synod is carrying out a discernment to see.
There are women here like Helena Jessepin Spuler. She has said, I believe in women's ordination. She believes, and she's not the only woman who believes, that women should be ordained.
What
do you say to the women?
But we are not discussing on the opinion of each or that member. We have...
Her bishop also thinks the same thing.
We have, but we have all the church that is listening, us listening and is listening, and then we'll discern. I cannot say, yes or not, me... By sure, but on this or on that, a woman, a man, a member said, we have to understand what the church will decide. And I think that if you go through what the Pope said yesterday morning in the homily, you will find the answer. Yesterday morning in the homily, yesterday afternoon the opening of the synod, and also in the veglia di preghiera di sabato scorso. Adesso però diventa un'intervista dopo.
Sì, non è un dibattito, dai, per favore, domande.
This is not a debate, just questions and answers. First question from the Figaro is concerning the discernment method. You said that discernment should be carried out within entire assembly, but the description of the decision process seems to demonstrate or to show that between convergence and divergence in the small groups, all this material is sent to the General Secretariat of the Synod, which then is sent to the General Congregation, and then there is all this process. But then eventually, who decides between disagreements and agreements or convergences or divergences? It seems that the entire, that it's the Secretary General that decides. Second question. Okay, let's take one question at a time. No, but this is important because we are here to work. Sorry, what you talk about, this abstinence from information that you were talking about. So when is this abstinence, so to speak, this fasting, when is this going to stop? Because we don't know when we are going to get to participate in a real press conference, which is what was normally done once a week. So we need to try and understand. Yes, at the end of these weeks, yes, we're going to have something to eat if we continue with this image of fasting, of abstinence from food. Well, this is serious because the synod is something that should also be shared with the outside world. Okay, well, I have to start by saying that sometimes, and I understand you because I was a journalist for many years, but sometimes my feeling is that in your questions, it's normal that we try to imagine the end of something. If it's a football game, we try to imagine the outcome or in an election. But I cannot give you an answer on what is going to come at the end, because we are truly just at the beginning. This is just something that I want to say to start with, because what I'm meaning is, let's try to go on step by step. So it's not the General Secretary or the Special Secretaries or the Secretariat of the Synod which acts motu proprio, because as I explained how the process takes place, then I think there is something else that perhaps is not entirely clear, and I will try to explain, but somehow it's also explained in Instrumentum Laboris. As I said, not just the synods in general, but this synod is not a decision-making arena. And in addition, we are halfway through a synod, so I don't know what how these reports are going to be, but I would imagine that. So I'm not talking about a certainty, I'm talking about a possibility as it occurred during some continental assemblies. It may be that the final report or the final reports show points of convergence and divergence. So again, they may represent a journey, a path that we are following. So you cannot ask this synod to sketch, to outline, or this assembly to sketch the outcome of the next assembly. So there too, perhaps this is not clear, and if it's not clear, I apologize, it's probably my fault. But the process is this. So, if I go through again what I try to illustrate, in the small circles, people discuss, and then people pray and debate, and then a report is drafted in which there are going to be points of convergence and divergence, then this report, which is just verbal, and then it becomes written down, is voted. The written report then is sent to the drafters of the synthesis document, which is going to come back again to the small circles and to the general congregations before it is approved. So it's a complex process, but it is a process that ensures that everybody can propose their points of view. So whoever wishes to do so may take the floor during the general congregation, and they can send their written text to the secretariat of the synod. So this is a truly a process of communion. And so we told you that, bearing in mind that there is this method, and which is per se a piece of news, in my opinion. It may be sound funny to you, but it seems to me a piece of information which is important, that such a great organization or institution in a world in which everything is instantaneous, is very fast, stops for a moment, as the Pope said, and takes a break to reflect. So we live in a world in which we never stop, not even for a second, to reason, to think. And that is why I was saying that this thing can be related also to many other issues or topics in which we know that it is important to stop and think. I'm quoting the apostolic exhortation, let us stop for a moment and think. But I'm here, and I'm trying to answer questions. So it is a fasting, but I'm trying to give you some food for thought. And we said that at the end of every module, while respecting, of course, this method, which is in line with the procedure, there are going to be press conferences. So I think there's going to be one on Saturday. I know it's inconvenient, but module A ends on Saturday. So I think we're going to come here, not just myself for a briefing, not just myself and Sheila, but with some members of the synod. But if you ask questions to ask me, what did you decide? We have no answer. If you ask questions on what I said personally, well, you have the rules, but we can tell you in which way we are addressing these topics, because why are we adopting this methodology? To be within an effort, an attempt, if you wish, to demonstrate that it is possible to listen to each other, even people who have got different opinions, but who share the same faith, and get to a consensus in communion while, and you can read the words of the Pope, I don't need to quote them. Otherwise, it's not a synod, it's a sort of a census of things that you know very well, the people of God, to refer to the question asked by Diane, already knows. So what should we expect, and what new is going to come from this? Well, maybe It's not necessarily going to be something that has to do on certain themes, but perhaps something is going to come up on another topic. We don't know. I say this as a believer. I realize that you are under no obligation to have faith. Faith is a gift. But even those who are not believers, and this is based on my past experience in different jobs in the journalistic field, I know, and you know, that in complex institutions, these opportunities for exchange do exist. And at the end of the day, you may take a political decision, an economic decision, but ultimately, trying to anticipate it would probably bring to no decision at all. So this is what is happening. It's complicated and simple at the same time. Thank you. So if there are no further questions, Inya Chen Grao. So what is striking from the struck me from the instrumental laboratories is that so many different topics are addressed. So for us, it's going to be interesting to understand which are the topics which are actually going to be discussed, and then because it's clear that over 35 groups in the instrumentum laboratories in the different modules really address all the topics that are relevant to the church today. So then we would like, it's interesting to know which route is a discussion taking what is being discussed, because this is not a council which is going to come up with 20 documents, and everything has to be distilled in a final report. And so what is going to be given prevalence or priority, since the instrumentum laboris addresses in a broad way all the themes of the church? Well, I am no prophet. I don't have the gift of prophecy, so I don't know what is going to happen. What we are discussing in this module is we are going to give you a couple of pages on what we are discussing. As far as the modules B1, B2, B3 is already in the instrumentum laboris, so you can see what the topics addressed are. The instrumentum laboris comes from a listening phase, so there is a lot of material, and we shall see in the discussions what is going to emerge from the exchanges. But this is what it is, and then eventually at the end, and I cannot predict the forecast the future, but if I had to say something, the result of all this may be perhaps another sort of instrumentum laboris. It's going to be different from other synods. So this is the process. So what we may come up with is perhaps another instrumentum laboris-like document. It's a first experience for me. It's a very spiritual experience, this I can say. And so all the topics that you imagine can be addressed when you speak about communion, synodality, how to involve the people who are furthest or those who are closest, this is what we do. It's a beautiful experience of spiritual sharing, and we shall see little by little. So we can also say that yesterday some questions were handed out to the participants. Yes, well, we didn't have this form yet. We will send it to you. Some questions were asked to participants. It was sort of a homework, in a sense. I have a photograph of the paper that was given me, but I don't want to share my notes. I must think and pray. This is another important thing. If you want to, we were given yesterday this sheet of paper which we are going to share with you, and we were asked to pray last night, during the night, and this morning before coming to the synod. And the question for discernment was based on Module A, starting from the synodal pathway of the local church you come from and from, based on the content of the instrumental laboris, what unique signs in a synodal church emerge with the greatest clarity and which need to be further recognized and highlighted and delved deeper into? Of course, everybody gave their personal witness on this question. You're going to be given this form, and then there were questions that were developed for the preparatory prayer. Tomorrow there's also going to be another briefing, Diane, so...
To
have a follow-up to Mr. Ingrao's question, would it be possible at least to have to know about the topics that were addressed within the groups? Because, in fact, it's true that there are so many different topics in the Instrumentum Laboris, so without saying what you talked about, even though it would be good, but at least know what topics were addressed. Even though I'm clear about the four modules, but yes, well, there are 35 groups. There are 35 groups, and for me it was truly impossible to have an insight concerning all the 35 groups. I came here only in the awareness of the fact that there was this serene sharing among all the groups. Those who participated in the sacrofanal retreat had already participated in similar groups there, so it was easier for them to be a part of this mechanism vis-à-vis the others. And in every group, the journey taken by one's own church to the Synod was shared, so how it started, how it evolved, what is communion, what difficulties emerged or were met in connection with the relationship between the local church and the universal church. So from what I understood, this is what is being discussed. So we are truly at the beginning, in a first small group or circle, a first small group session in which we started first of all introducing ourselves, then look at the module, and then a discussion was started on what, on where we are in the synodal process, how we can describe our experience up until today. So it is a good thing because we all talked about different things, and it was different also based on languages and continents. Sorry, we cannot translate the question into English because it's not asked into a live microphone. We cannot hear you, Diane. A further question? Yes, a simple question.
Whatever the final synthesis that comes out of this assembly, not the final, what will be voted on? Will proposals be voted on, or will the members be voting on whether they agree that this was an accurate representation?
I can't answer on something that is not written. We will see when it will be. I really don't know. There is not the document to be voted, so I cannot answer. I can. Non lo so perché non c'è ancora il documento, non c'è ancora, non lo so.
Abbiamo un'ultima domanda qua.
Last question here from the gentleman. If you can introduce yourself, please.
Grazie. E poi chiudiamo.
And then we finish. Tomorrow there's going to be another opportunity. Franco Ferrari from Missione Oggi, a magazine, a journal. I'm not sure I've understood correctly. So the entire section A is devoted to an exchange on the way in which every member of the assembly has experienced the synodal journey up until today. Well, you find the detailed explanation in the Instrument Laboris. Yes, I saw this, but it seemed to me, from what we read in the Instrumentum Laboris, there would be something more. Well, of course, I'm talking about Section B, but also in Section A. Section A, we say, starting from your experience of the synodal journey, what does the church need to be more synodal? So there too, it's a broad and open question, and you can truly answer in several different ways. What is asked is try at least to start from one's own experience, from a journey made, the experience of the difficulties and successes, joys and sorrows in one's church, what the member wishes to say. So it's making this more concrete, starting from concrete aspects to then arrive to proposal, convergences, points of divergence. This is the most general part. What is the synodal church? Thank you, everybody. Thank you to our colleagues who have taken the floor and those who haven't been able to do so, and see you tomorrow.
And now we conclude the first briefing of the 16th General Ordinary Assembly of the Synod of Bishops. As you heard during the briefing, there will be another one tomorrow, and they will take place all at the same time. So if you'd like to keep up with the Synod, come back for more. Laudetur Jesus Christus.